পিস টিভি বাংলা মানবতা সমাধান
Line answer is sufficient. God himself paid the price.
And Jesus said, I am.
I'm a non-vegetarian.
21st century will belong to vegetarians.
This cause of death in the world. Veg or non-veg? If I prove that an apple is better than a mango, that doesn't mean mango is prohibited.
I have some problems with this. Man has become an animal.
He's more like a lawyer than like a scientist.
Quran is incomplete.
There's a misconception. Neither a single verse which is against establishment. And I challenge Dr. William Gamble.
It's a different situation. I will not tempt God.
That apologize if I've hurt the feelings of any Christians. It was just a reply to Dr. William Campbell's book.
The brother has asked a very complicated question.
The answer is very clear.
Major minor religion, fraud is prohibited.
Ask me a direct question, I'll be too willing to give you a reply.
Is milk veg or non-veg? If this was not done, life on the earth would have ceased to exist.
Then could you please prove it authentically?
The word Trinity doesn't exist.
It's CDC baat hai.
Smoking is prohibited. That's final.
I hope I have answered properly.
It's illogical and unsound. That does not mean Quran is wrong.
It has really moved me.
I'm your host Akash Berry, and in the studio we have with us Dr. Zakir Naik. Dr. Zakir Naik has been given the exclusion order by the Home Secretary of the UK government to prevent him from entering UK. Dr. Zakir Naik, the eminent speaker from Mumbai, India, is respected world over for his enlightening and convincing efforts of promoting similarities between major faiths based on converging values for a common platform of peace that exists between the religious scriptures, including the Bible, Vedas, Torah, and the glorious Quran. As a student of comparative religion, Dr. Zakir Naik has worked tirelessly for the common good amongst people of all faiths, engaging in constructive debate and dialogue. These discussions have been hugely successful and have resulted in much progress towards a better understanding of Islam, as well as enhanced harmony between people of different beliefs, dispelling fears and misunderstandings. Dr. Zakir Naik is undoubtedly an opponent of terrorism and as such has often spoken out against all acts of violence and violent extremism. He has emphatically condemned the killing of civilians and is one of the world's regular noted orators on this topic. We have with us in the studio Dr. Zakir Naik, and we would like to know from him what are his views regarding the exclusion order. Welcome, sir.
It's my pleasure to be with you.
Sir, you were supposed to visit UK for a lecture tour. So can you give us in detail, tell us in detail about this lecture tour, and also was it your first visit to UK as a part of the lecture tour?
Alhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalam ala rasulillah. I've been traveling to UK for the past 15 years, and I've been to UK more than 10 times, and I've given lectures in several cities of UK. I've given several lectures in London, in Birmingham, in Bradford, in Manchester, in Glasgow, in Cardiff, and many other cities of UK. So this was not supposed to be my first lecture tour to UK. And this particular trip, it was supposed to have three lectures of mine. The first one was supposed to be held in Sheffield Arena in Sheffield on the 25th of June, that's on Friday evening. The second was supposed to be held in the prestigious Wembley Arena in London on the 26th of June, that's a Saturday. And the last was supposed to be held in the National Exhibition Centre, that is the LG Arena in Birmingham, on the 27th of June, that's Sunday evening. So these three lectures are supposed to be held. And the topic of my first lecture in Sheffield Arena was supposed to be Understanding Islam and Peace. And the second lecture in Wembley Arena, the topic was Universal Brotherhood. And the third lecture in Birmingham NEC, it was supposed to be Freedom of Expression and Islamic Perspective.
Sir, could you also tell us what is the background of this exclusion order which has been served to you by the British government?
It actually initially started. There was an article that came more than 2 weeks back on 30th of May, 2010, in a newspaper by the name of Sunday Times.
Okay.
And the title of the article was Muslim Preacher of Hate Let into Britain. And the same article quoted many of my speeches out of context. They misquoted me and tried to prove that I am a person who promotes terrorism. And later on, immediately the next day, the same article was reproduced and rehashed by four or five different newspapers of UK, okay, including Daily Star, Daily Express, Sheffield Telegraph, and some other newspaper. Okay. And because of this, this was one of the reasons that put pressure on this new conservative government.
Okay.
To prevent me from entering, and the article said that how has this new government permitted me to enter UK to give a series of lectures, and they tried to portray that I'm a person who promotes terrorism and violence.
Okay. So when were you officially informed about this exclusion order?
The first time that I was officially told about this exclusion order from the Home Secretary was 2 days back, on the 17th of June. And this order was passed on 16th of June. And I received a phone call early in the morning, day before yesterday, that is the 17th of June, from the British High Commission, telling me that I got a letter from the Home Secretary of UK, and she has excluded your entry into UK.
And so what do you think are the possible reasons for this exclusion order being given to you, which prevents you from entering UK?
I feel that because today Islam is the fastest growing religion in the world, it is the fastest growing religion in the Western countries, including UK. I feel this may be one of the major reasons that the new UK government does not want Islam to spread in UK. And they know very well that amongst all the Muslim speakers, the speaker that gets the maximum audience throughout the world, wherever he travels, is Dr. Zakir Naik. So I feel that I was made a scapegoat.
Okay.
And because there was a pressure on this new government, I think it was a political decision. It was not a legal decision. They know very well, the Home Office knows very well, that I'm a person who normally is against terrorism. I'm a person who speaks against violence. I think it was a pressure on the new government, because they used to always oppose the previous government, that why do they allow Muslim speakers to come in. So now, because of this article that came in the newspaper, and there were pressure, there was political pressure, they were forced. And what they did, that they quoted me out of context. And they killed two birds with one stone. First, they prevented the true message of Islam to spread in UK. And they don't want Islam to spread. And secondly, because of misquoting me, they tried to prove that I'm a person who promotes terrorism so that they can prove to the world that this government is against terrorism. So I think it was a political decision.
So according to the few press releases, the UK Home Secretary has prevented you from entering UK because of the following statements, like every Muslim should be a terrorist, and the statement supporting Osama bin Laden, and also Western women make themselves more susceptible to rape by wearing revealing clothes. So what are your comments on them?
As far as the three statements you have mentioned, only two were mentioned out of the four that they gave reasons in the letter which excluded me. The first one is absolutely out of context. As far as the second statement is concerned, of me supporting Osama bin Laden, it is again out of context and it is manipulated. And the third statement wasn't mentioned in the letter which they told me.
Okay. So, according to you, which are the statements which actually the UK Home Secretary found objectionable? And could you also clarify each one of them?
Well, I feel that what she has given in the media is different than the letter what was presented to me. What was presented to media is just one statement. And the official exclusion order which I received from the Home Secretary by hand delivery, I'll read it to you, it's verbatim. The Home Secretary has considered whether, in light of this approach, you should be excluded from the UK. After careful consideration, on 16th June 2010, she personally directed that you should be excluded from the UK on the grounds that your presence here would not be conducive to the public good. The Home Secretary notes that you have made the following statements amongst others, and she has pointed out 4 statements from my lectures which she finds as objectionable. And inshallah, I'll give reply to each one of them. The first statement that she found objectionable, it's in quote, as far as terrorist is concerned, this is my quotation, what she has given. As far as terrorist is concerned, I tell the Muslims that every Muslim should be a terrorist. What is the meaning of the word terrorist? Terrorist by definition means a person who terrorizes. When a robber sees a policeman, he's terrified. So for a robber, the policeman is a terrorist. So in this context, every Muslim should be a terrorist to the robber. Every Muslim should be a terrorist to each and every antisocial element. I'm aware that terrorist more commonly is used for a person who terrorizes an innocent person. In this context, no Muslim should even terrorize a single innocent human being. The Muslim should selectively terrorize the antisocial elements. And many times, 2 different labels are given to the same activity of the same individual. Before any person gives any label to any individual for any of his actions, we have to first analyze for what reason is he doing that. Now, reading in context, I don't have to give any clarification that I'm not promoting terrorism. I'm saying very clearly that no Muslim should ever kill any innocent human being. What she does, she picks up a statement of mine out of context and says, Dr. Zakir Naik says, every Muslim should be a terrorist. It's absolutely out of context. Because I give in the context and she knows the context. But to the press, she is only mentioning one of my statements. But in my letter, she gives the context. The reason I feel is that if she gives the full context in the press, it would be obvious that I'm not promoting terrorism. But she knows that I'm going to challenge this exclusion order in the High Court of UK. That's the reason in my letter, she has mentioned the full thing so she can say that she's not quoting out of context. So if she really was truthful, she should have given the full paragraph what she has written in my letter to the press. Because the paragraph clearly states that terrorist means a person who terrorizes. And in this context, when a robber sees a policeman, he's terrified. So for the robber, the policeman is a terrorist. So in this context, every Muslim should be a terrorist. Whenever a robber sees a Muslim, he should be terrified. Whenever a robber sees any anti-social element, he should be terrified. And I further go on to clarify that I know more commonly the word terrorist is used for a person who terrorizes an innocent human being. In this context, no Muslim should ever terrorize any innocent human being. I'm very clear. I have to tell the press that she has excluded me from entering UK because I said that no Muslim should even terrorize a single innocent human being. If I go to the press and say that she has banned me, she has excluded me from UK because she objected on my one sentence that I said no Muslim should even terrorize a single innocent human being. So what I feel, it's out of context. And there may be people who will say that why do you use such language? See, this is English language. And if you hear my original lecture, it was talking about an article that came in Times of India in 2003, talking about a very famous inspector by the name of Inspector Angre. And the article says that Inspector Angre terrorizes the underworld. So in this context, I've said that this word terrorist means a person who terrorizes. So in this context, I said that whenever a robber sees a policeman, he's terrified. So in context, it is very clear. I'm telling the Muslims that you should see to it that the anti-social element gets scared of the Muslim. At the same time, no Muslim should ever terrorize any innocent human being. It's absolutely clear. So I don't see any reason that why should this statement be objectionable to the UK government. And the second statement that she feels is objectionable, that she quotes, and she says, and she quotes me, that beware of Muslims saying Osama bin Laden is right or wrong. I reject them. We don't know. But if you ask my view, if given the truth, if he's fighting the enemies of Islam, I'm for him. I don't know what he's doing. I'm not in touch with him. I don't know him personally. I read the newspaper. If he's terrorizing the terrorist, if he's terrorizing America, the terrorist, the biggest terrorist, he's following Islam. In bracket, source, YouTube, 2006. When I read this statement which had come earlier in the UK press, I immediately went to the YouTube and I saw and I realized that this lecture of mine was not given in 2006, it was given in 1996. So imagine they are attributing this lecture to 2006 and any normal person, you don't have to be an intelligent CID or belong to Scotland Yard, to see that you can easily see that I'm looking 15 years younger. And there you can see my physique and you can see my face. They can easily judge that it's an old video. And this was given in Singapore. And I've never been to Singapore in 2006. This lecture of mine was a lecture given in Singapore in 1996. And it was shot by the local organizers. And later on, some prejudiced group, what they did, they manipulated and they cut-paste my lecture, and they present it on the YouTube. Now, how can a clipping of YouTube presented by an unknown person without any proof can act as evidence against me? What I say, this clip is manipulated, and irrespective whether it's manipulated or not, this statement of mine that they've shown on YouTube was not given in 2006. It was given in 1996, which was 5 years before 9/11 attack. So how can they attribute this statement? And if you read in context, if this has been mentioned 5 years before, in no way can you attribute this statement to 9/11. And that is the explanation I gave in the press release, that this was manipulated. And this can never be as an evidence, because you cannot take a clipping from YouTube which shows cuts in between. So I feel that this is no vice on the part of the UK government to take a clipping from YouTube and then attributing it to 2006 and then saying that I said this and I'm supporting Osama bin Laden. There are many journalists and many people in Kashmir's session, they ask me, what are my views regarding Osama bin Laden? And I always say that I don't know. I cannot base my views on what BBC and CNN say, because the Quran clearly mentions in Surah Hujurat, chapter number 49, verse number 6, that whenever you get information, you check it up before you pass it on to the third person. I cannot base my views on BBC or CNN, otherwise I'll have to say that he's a terrorist. So therefore, when anyone asks me the question, what are your views regarding Osama bin Laden, I say, I don't know. He's neither my friend, he's neither my enemy. I neither consider him as a terrorist, neither do I consider him like a saint. I'm neutral. I said, I don't know. Just because I say I don't know, that does not mean that I am a supporter of bin Laden. Just because I say I don't know, they can attribute that I am promoting terrorism. It's totally unacceptable. And I would like to ask a simple question to the Home Secretary of UK. That suppose, hypothetically, the UK government arrests bin Laden today. And suppose he's going to have a trial after a few days in the UK High Court. Before the trial takes place, if a journalist or if the Home Secretary, Theresa May, herself asks the judge who's going to take the trial of Osama bin Laden, what are your views about Osama bin Laden? Is he responsible for 9/11? Is he a terrorist? What will be the reply of that judge? What will he say? But naturally he'll say that let the trial take place. And only after evidence is posed and he verifies the evidence can he say, even though he may be the judge of the High Court or the judge of Supreme Court, in any country, he will give his verdict only after the trial is over. So similarly, because I have a large following, there are hundreds of millions of people who watch my program on the different satellite channels, I have to be careful. Just because I say I don't know, and that will be the same statement given by the Supreme Court judge or by the High Court judge, I don't know. So that time, will the Home Secretary exclude the High Court judge or the Supreme Court judge from UK? So in the same way, I being a responsible citizen, I being a responsible person, I have not verified all the claims. And I'm not the judge. If any court arrests him and convicts him after proof, then there are chances. No one has arrested him. These are only evidences given. Now those who have the evidence and they are convinced, if they blame him, they have a right. I'm not objecting why they're blaming them. But why should I? So I, as a good Muslim who has not verified these claims, have not done research on it, the best reply a Muslim should give is, I don't know. Now, those who have proved, those who are calling, it's different. Similarly, when the High Court judge is asked, he as an intelligent person will say, I don't know, unless he undergoes the trial and verifies the evidences and has a cross-examination, then he can say for sure whether he is innocent or is responsible, whether he's a terrorist or whether he's a saint.
Assalamu alaikum. Ami Muhammad Badruddin Nadwi. Apnara dekhchen Peace TV Bangla.
Bandar upor Allahr odhikar. Manusher proti manusher odhikar. জীব জন্তুর অধিকার আমি মোহাম্মদ হাশিম মাদানি আপনারা দেখছেন পিস টিভি বাংলা
শেখ হাশিম মাদানি
কিভাবে ইসলাম বিভিন্ন সৃষ্টিকে অধিকার দিয়ে ওদের সুরক্ষিত করেছে জানার জন্য দেখুন ইসলামী অধিকার
দেখুন অধিকার সমূহ প্রতি মঙ্গলবার সন্ধ্যা 5টায় আপনার সম্প্রচার রাত 12টায় বাংলাদেশে পিস টিভি বাংলায়
her third statement that she feels was objectionable, that she quotes me saying that, how can you ever justify killing innocent people? But in the same breath, as condemning those responsible, we must also condemn those responsible for the deaths of thousands of innocent people in Iraq, Afghanistan and Lebanon. In bracket, as reported by the Manchester Evening News, 21st August 2006, as part of a speech you gave, that means I gave, at the Expo Islamia conference in Manchester. Immediately I went to the net and I typed and I went on to the Manchester Evening News, 21st August 2006, and I was shocked. Immediately before the statement, I said that I condemn the attack that took place in 9/11, mm-hmm. took place on 7/7, 11/7, the Twin Towers, the London bombing, the serial bomb blast in Bombay. But I said you should not put a full stop here. And the report says that. But in the same breath, I even condemn, then I said this, we must also condemn those responsible for the deaths of thousands of innocent people in Iraq, Afghanistan and Lebanon, whether in context or not. So why is she quoting part of it? Even if I agree, I only made this statement that we must condemn those responsible for the deaths of thousands of innocent people in Iraq, Afghanistan, Lebanon. Does the UK government does not want me to condemn the innocent people killed in Afghanistan, innocent people killed in Iraq, innocent people killed in Lebanon? She says it is the privilege for a person to enter UK and she has the right to prevent anyone, and I do agree with her. That means if any innocent life is saved in UK, if he's a British national, it's a privilege. And if an innocent UK citizen is killed, then the killer should be condemned. But if thousands of innocent lives are being taken in Afghanistan, in Iraq, in Lebanon, and if I'm condemning the killers, she's objecting. So does it mean that the UK government wants that the innocent people in Afghanistan should be killed, the innocent people in Iraq should be killed, the innocent people in Lebanon should be killed? I don't understand what is objectionable in this statement. Do you find anything objectionable that we must also condemn those responsible for the deaths of thousands of innocent people in Iraq, Afghanistan and Lebanon? I don't really find what is objectionable. I am 100% condemning any innocent human being killed, whether it be in UK, whether it be in America, whether India, Lebanon, Iraq, Afghanistan, whether it be Muslim, whether it be non-Muslim. The fourth statement that she quoted of mine, which she found objectionable, and I'm quoting, strongest in enmity towards the Muslims are the Jews and the pagans. It, in bracket the Quran, does not say that the Muslims should fight the Jews. The Jews, by nature as a whole, will be against Muslims. There are many Jews who are good to Muslims, but as a whole, the Quran tells us, as a whole, they will be our staunchest enemy. Peace TV, recorded on YouTube. Now, this statement is of mine. And this was in context to a quotation I gave of the Quran, of Surah Maidah, chapter number 5, verse number 82, which does say that strongest in enmity towards the believers are the pagans and the Jews. And the closest to the believers are those who say that we are Christians. So in this context, but I further went on to clarify that the Quran does not say that Muslims should fight the Jews. And I further said, there are many Jews who are good to Muslims. But as a whole, the Quran tells us that the Jews will be the staunchest enemy. So this is the verse of the Quran. But I'm going out of the way to say that does not mean that the Muslims should fight the Jew. It does not mean that 100% all the Jews will be against Muslims. So what is wrong in this statement? This is the verse of the Quran. We as Muslims, we believe this is a word of God. And you can see around the world that as a whole, you can see around in the world, whether it be in Israel, whether it be other parts of the world. And the Quran is right in making that statement, that as a whole, the Jews will be against the Muslims. So I want to know that these four statements of mine, what is objectionable? It is absolutely condemning violence and condemning terrorism in unequivocal terms. But what I feel that this was more of a political decision, and the government knows very well, and the world knows that I have given several lectures against terrorism, against violence, and I've quoted the Quran many times. That Quran says in Surah Maida, chapter number 5, verse number 32, that if anyone kills any other human being, whether it be Muslim or non-Muslim, unless it be for murder or for spreading corruption in the land, it is as though he has killed the whole of humanity. And if any person saves any human being, it is as though he has saved the whole of humanity. So in unequivocal terms, I have condemned terrorism several times. And I have been the chief speaker in many of the peace conferences. And I have been called by several heads of states, not only of Muslim governments, even non-Muslim governments. I've met many heads of states. So does the UK government want to tell that all these heads of states and all these intelligence, they are calling a person who promotes terrorism, they're calling a person who promotes violence? Is the UK government giving a message to the world that all the heads of states that meet me regularly, that they are fools? So what message is the UK government giving to the world? And I have traveled to several countries of the world, Muslims and non-Muslims, and I've met many government officials. They call me, they invite me. We have a lunch, we have a dinner, we have a tea. So does the UK government want to give a message that all the other governments are fools and only their intelligence is correct?
So, sir, after all this has happened to you, what's your further plan of action, immediate plan of action?
Our immediate plan of action is that we are going to challenge the exclusion order of the Home Office, done by the Home Secretary, in the UK High Court. We will file a judiciary revision. What I believe, I have more faith in the judicial system rather than the politicians. I have more faith in the judicial system of India. I also have faith in the judicial system of UK rather than the politicians. And inshallah, hopefully, in the next few days, in the next week, we have hired a team, a battery of very good solicitors and a battery of lawyers, as well as QCs, known as Queen Counsels. And very shortly, within the next few days, the next couple of days, we'll be filing a revision, a judicial revision. And we'll take the matter to the High Court and we'll challenge the exclusion order of the UK government. And inshallah, this order would be reversed.
Sir, you must have received, I'm sure, hundreds of phone calls and emails from the fans throughout the world. So any message for them particularly, all your
fans? You're right that I've received hundreds of phone calls in the past couple of days and thousands of emails from my fans and from different parts of the world. And many of them said that they're sad, they're angry, they want to protest. So I said, even if you want to protest, please see to it that the protest is peaceful. Don't make it violent, otherwise it will spoil the name of Islam. There are many doctors, scholars, lawyers, politicians from different parts of the world, they phoned me. And they wrote emails, and they said, what can we do? And they are very angry. And if you go and have a look at the website where these articles have come, mostly in the UK press, there is always on the website, there is a comment page where you can give your comments. So most of the comments, more than 95%, all of them are saying that what the UK government has done, they totally disagree with it. Because these people have seen me on the television. They said, how could they blame a person who's been speaking against terrorism, who's been speaking against violence for so many years unequivocally? So surely, if the government really goes and reads the comments of all these thousands of people, and what we feel, that if there is a protest, it should be peaceful, it should not be violent, and we should express our anger in a peaceful way.
That's a great thought, sir. Sir, you believe that this whole exclusion order is a political decision. So any message particularly you would like to give to the UK politicians?
Yes, I do think it's a political decision. I may be wrong, I'm a human being, but that's my opinion. So what my message to the politicians of UK, whether they're Muslims or non-Muslims, this is the time of test. Whether do they support the truth or do they support a political decision? So if he is a politician in UK, whether Muslim or non-Muslim, whether belong to a ruling party or the opposition party, the truth is very evident. It is a test for them that do they support the truth or do they support the political decision so that they secure their seat.
Okay. And sir, what about the other politicians, like politicians of India and the rest of the world? What would you like to tell them in particularly?
My message to them, and I did receive many calls from politicians from India and from other parts of the world, and they said that we will get together and we will give our letter to the UK government saying that what they have done is totally wrong. And the many Indian politicians phoned me, but naturally, as far as the Indian politicians are concerned, that they should write a letter or a protest against the UK government, knowing that they have called an Indian who has always been speaking against terrorism, against violence, unequivocally. And I also happen to be amongst, in the list of the 100 most influential or powerful people in India. They ranked me last year 82 and this year 89th in the list. And last year I was third on the spiritual, top 10 spiritual gurus. And this year I was on top. So maligning an Indian who speaks against violence and against terrorism to say that he's promoting terrorism, it is an insult for the Indian government. So surely I believe that very shortly the Indian government should write a letter of protest that what they have done is wrong, and they should write a protest that they should reverse the decision of the exclusion of mine to UK.
So that's a very thoughtful thought. And sir, thank you so much for your time. That was my last question of the evening. And that was Dr. Zakir Naik. And he's pretty much answered all the questions put in front of him. And it's just a waiting game. We wish him all the best. And that's all from the studio. This is Akash Beri signing off. Thank you so much.
ইসলাম থেকে দূর অবৈধ সম্পদের মোহ বিপথে গমন অপসংস্কৃতির চর্চা আরো অনেক সমস্যা হতাশাগ্রস্ত যুব সমাজ
কেন আমাদের যুবকের জন্য জরুরি ইসলামের আলো আধুনিক সভ্যতা ও আমাদের যুব সমাজ প্রতি সোমবার ও মঙ্গলবার রাত 11:30 আর পুনঃ সম্প্রচার সকাল 10:30 বাংলাদেশে পিএস টিভি বাংলায়। মানবতা সমাধান।
And totally betraying the least principles of a civil society is that it is not appealable.
They call Dr. Naik a warmonger. Well, history knows who is the warmonger.
It is their plan to ban me, and I have faith in my creator Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who will see to it that the more they try to suppress my voice, inshallah, more louder it will be.
And yet if you insist that no, our orders are divine orders, they cannot be looked into by any other human being or any other organization or authority, I'm afraid this is terrorism, an act of terrorism.
Are we going to become victims of these people who decide at the drop of the hat whom they're going to call terrorists and whom they're not going to call terrorists?
May peace be on all of you. On behalf of the Islamic Research Foundation, I, Dr. Mohammed Naik, who have this task of coordinating between the press and the speakers on the dais, welcome all of you wholeheartedly, as well as I welcome two prominent and very famous human rights activists of India, Mr. Mahesh Bhatt and Advocate Majid Memon. One very prominent in dealing with humanitarian aspect of such issues, another very prominently known as dealing on the legal issues on such cases. First and foremost, let me clarify. We have got together here today specifically to get a clear picture on the serious allegations put forward by the United Kingdom government, specifically its Home Department, on Dr. Zakir Naik, and putting a ban or an exclusion order on him. And this is our opportunity to have Dr. Zakir Naik's clarification and relevant response to this exclusion order. As I'm told that we have limited time available with us today, it would be fit that we don't convert this into a question and answer session on other general matters in which Dr. Zakir and our other speakers might be well versed with. Let us restrict ourselves to issues of terrorism and violence specifically, and if time permits, we'll allow you an open session after that. The British Home Office issued this order on 16 June 2010, just 1 or 2 days before Dr. Zakir was to arrive in the United Kingdom. And that too for a series of peace talks in some of the leading venues and cities of United Kingdom. Dr. Zakir has been regularly visiting the United Kingdom for the last 15 years for public talks and never has been misunderstood or mistreated ever in such a manner by the UK government. All his talks have been peaceful and there has never been an incident of violence ever in any of these talks. To give you an exact idea of what is the order and a response to it, we will have Dr. Zakir Naik. Before that, may I quickly read out at fast pace, because I think our volunteers here have already distributed the press release for your ready reference. Dr. Zakir Naik's banned by UK government. Dr. Zakir Naik filed legal case in British High Court to approach Ministry of External Affairs for support. This is the main theme of today's discussion. Mumbai, June 2, 2010. Dr. Zakir Naik, eminent Islamic scholar and international personality, has initiated legal proceedings against the UK government's exclusion order, banning him from entering Britain. Dr. Naik is also approaching the Minister of External Affairs, Mr. S. M. Krishna, for the ministry's support in revoking the order. Notably, the exclusion order by the British Home Office, UK Border Agency, was issued just 2 days before Dr. Zakir Naik's visit to UK on last Friday, June 18. It was to be a peace speaking tour between June 25 to 27 to audiences at three places, the Sheffield Arena, Sheffield, London's Wembley Arena, and the LG Arena in Birmingham, NEC. Post the exclusion order by the British Home Office, Dr. Naik's 5 years UK visa issued in 2008 and valid till 2013 was cancelled and notice issued banning him from entering the UK. Dr. Naik has initiated legal recourse in the High Court of London with a view to appeal against the exclusion order, terming the reasons of ban as untrue and misrepresentation of the truth. He is also approaching the Indian Ministry of External Affairs, the Prime Minister's office, and the British Embassy for revoking the ban. Says Dr. Naik, I have spoken out on numerous occasions against all and any facts of terrorism and have unequivocally condemned acts of violence, including 9/11, 7/7, and 7/11 serial train bombings in Mumbai incidents. I have said on several occasions that these are cowardly acts and completely unjustifiable by any standards. But I believe that the UK government has acted on recent press reports in the UK, which has portrayed me as a preacher of hate and a terror backer. That is not just a warped view, but totally unjustified impression of my work. It appears these sensational headlines have been based on some of my quotes that have been either used out of relevant context or are completely wrong. It is clear from many of my talks that in Islam, terrorism and killing of innocent civilians is completely forbidden. And as such, I have unequivocally stated several times that no Muslim should be a terrorist. However, what is more surprising is that the UK government, which has so many resources to its disposal, has acted on falsehoods of the media and without cross-checking the facts. Even a basic investigation into my speeches would have revealed the truth that I stand for peace and harmony and I'm strictly against terrorism of any kind, added Dr. Naik. Apparently, the ban is the latest in the series of UK government's naming and shaming policy introduced a couple of years ago, a law that some sections of the UK media have termed as impediment to free speech. The fact remains that Dr. Zakir Naik has visited the UK on several occasions in the past 15 years and his speaking tours have passed by without any incidents. The law is also being seen as an intrusion on the freedom of speech. This law called the government's naming and shaming policy law. The UK has sufficient number of laws to deal with incidents of hatred and violence, but the introduction of a law that preemptively bans people from entering the UK is being seen as yet another government PR gimmick to show that it is getting tough on extremism. Mumbai-based Dr. Naik has in recent years built up a huge international following of over 100 million plus viewers on Peace TV as well as on other satellite TV channels. Dr. Zakir Naik is revered for his enlightening and convincing talks on promoting similarities between major religions across the world. He uses peace as a common platform to converge values and commonalities between religious scriptures, including the Bible, Vedas, Torah, and Quran. He was listed among the 100 most powerful Indians in 2009 and 2010 in a research survey by a popular Indian media house. Dr. Zakir Naik has been peacefully visiting and delivering talks in the United Kingdom for the past 15 years. For further information on these technicalities, you can contact the Islamic Research Foundation and Mr. Maqbool Barwelkar for any further details. Without coming any further in between you and the speakers on stage, I leave the floor open to Dr. Zakir Naik to make his comments. You are welcome, as soon as the comment is over, to put forward your questions. Dr. Zakir Naik.
Alhamdulillah. Wassalatu wassalam ala rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajmain. Amma ba'd. A'udhu billahi minash shaitani rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Wa qul ja'al haqq wa zaqal batil. Innal batil kana zahuka. Rabbi shrahli sadri wa yassir li amri wa hlul 'uqdata min lisani yafqahu qawli. The Honorable Human Rights Activist, Advocate Majid Memon, Mr. Mahesh Bhatt, the press, the media, the respected elders, and my dear brothers and sisters. I welcome all of you with the Islamic greetings. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May peace, mercy, and blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of Almighty God, be on all of you. As you may be aware, that I was supposed to go for a series of lectures to UK, which is supposed to be held in the three most prestigious arenas on the 25th, 26th, and 27th of June in Sheffield Arena, in Sheffield, in Wembley Arena in London, and LG Arena, NEC Birmingham. Since there was a lot of publicity being done in UK, just a couple of weeks or a month before the event took place, on the 30th of May, there was a newspaper in UK by the name of Sunday Times, which published an article saying, "The preacher of hate let into Britain," talking about me. And in that article, they gave several references of my speeches, which were misquotes, or they were quoted out of context. And they projected me as a person, saying that I'm a person who says that every Muslim should be a terrorist, and other allegations, which in our press release on the 11th of June, we did clarify that all these allegations, these assumptions, they're quoted out of context, or they're misquotes. This led to a pressure on the newly elected government in UK, that is the Conservative Party. When it was early and the opposition was very vehemently against, you should not allow speakers who speak wrong things. So there's a pressure on this government that they should exclude me from coming to UK. And we made a presentation to the Home Office clarifying and giving the context and saying in no way do I promote terrorism in any way, and I have condemned all acts of terrorism and killing of any innocent human being in the world, irrespective whether it be 9/11 in New York, whether it be 7/7 in London, 7/11 in Bombay. But yet instead of all this presentation, I think this decision to exclude me, according to me, was more of a political decision rather than a legal decision. Because they were newly elected, hardly 1.5 months in power. And because of the political pressure from the various groups, the government decided to take the chance, knowing very well that we will be challenging this exclusion order. Yet they preferred taking a political decision for political mileage, that's what I believe. And they gave an exclusion order on 16th of June because I was supposed to leave on 18th early morning, or rather 17th late night, to UK. Knowing that, they gave an exclusion order on 16th, which was given to me by hand delivery on the 17th of June, just one day before my travel. We received a phone call from the Deputy High Commission in Bombay of UK, saying that there's a letter, there's an exclusion order given to you, please come and collect the letter, and I sent my manager, and he collected the letter.
লকার আপনার সম্পদকে সুরক্ষিত না রাখতে পারে, বিনিয়োগ আপনার সম্পদকে না বৃদ্ধি করতে পারে, কিন্তু যাকাত দিলে নিশ্চয়ই আপনার সম্পদ বাড়বে, থাকবে সুরক্ষিত এবং পবিত্র।
পিস টিভির সাথে থাকুন, আপনার যাকাত ও দানের অর্থ পাঠাতে পারেন IRFI আল্রায়ান ব্যাংক, কোয়াড্রান কোর্ট 48 গ্যালথরপে রোড, বার্মিংহাম UK, পাউন্ড অ্যাকাউন্ট নাম্বার 0113230 1, IBAN GB52 LOYD 3096340102419, শর্ট কোড 300083, সোয়েব BIC কোড IBO BZB 22. টাকা পাঠিয়ে আমাদের ইমেল করুন admin@peacetv.tv.
Peace TV, মানবতার সমাধান।
The students of Islamic International School welcome all of you. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Al-Malikul Quddus, Al-Salamu al-Mu'minu al-Mu'aymin.
MUSLIM, I'm so blessed to be with them. MUSLIM, I'm so blessed to be with them.
Don't know about you, I know about me. I'm proud cause I'm rolling Islamically. Everywhere I see, even on TV, people talking trash about the way I be. But what they all hate is if we get great, cause we're the only ones with our heads on straight. Don't ever frown and your head looking down. If you read the Quran, you're the best in the town.
MUSLIM, I'm so blessed to be with them.
Watch little wonders at their best. Bishoy Shishura proti budbar sondha 7tay apuno samprochar sokal 11tay Bangladeshe Peace TV Banglay.
And the reason is they gave in that exclusion order, they said there are certain passages of my speeches which they feel are not conducive, they aren't good for the public in UK, and they quoted 4 of the passages in their letter for the reasons they gave to exclude me, and those 4 passages which the Home Ministry, the Home Office, has given to us in writing is also given to the press, so that you yourself can be the judge whether what they say or is an exclusion order required on these 4 passages. I'll just clarify all these 4 passages, and then we'll have the comments from honorable people on the dais, and then the press is free. As we may be having those passages, the first passage which you objected on was, and I'm quoting, it is from their exact letter, which I received. As far as terrorist is concerned, I tell the Muslims that every Muslim should be a terrorist. This they're quoting me. Dot, dot, dot. What is the meaning of the word terrorist? Terrorist by definition means a person who terrorizes. When a robber sees a policeman, he's terrified. So for a robber, a policeman is a terrorist. So in this context, every Muslim should be a terrorist to the robber. Every Muslim should be a terrorist to each and every antisocial element. I'm aware that terrorist more commonly is used for a person who terrorizes an innocent person. In this context, no Muslim should ever terrorize a single innocent human being. The Muslim should selectively terrorize the antisocial elements. Many times, 2 different labels are given to the same activity of the same individual, dot, dot, dot. Before any person gives any label to any individual for any of his actions, we have to first analyze for what reason is he doing that. Source, video Google. Though in the press in UK, only one part of my sentence was flashed in the media. Dr. Zakir Naik says that every Muslim should be a terrorist. And because of that, all these issues started. And when we presented the case to the Home Office, the people who were the organizers, and they said it's out of context. So one thing good, for me at least, that when the UK Home Office has excluded me, they give the full passage in context. Now, any logical person who reads this does not require any clarification for what I've said. An article that came in Times of India on the 20th of August 2003 saying that Inspector Angre, amongst the five police officers who has killed more than 300 criminals, his name itself evokes terror in the underworld. So in this context, I said that terrorist means a person who causes terror. So when a robber sees a policeman or a criminal sees a policeman, he's terrified. So for the robber or the criminal, the policeman is a terrorist. In this context, every Muslim, whenever a robber or a criminal or an antisocial element looks at a Muslim, he should be terrified. But I went on to clarify that I'm aware that terrorist more commonly is used for a person who terrorizes an innocent person. In this context, no Muslim should ever terrorize a single innocent human being. So the main crux of this full paragraph is that no Muslim should ever terrorize a single innocent human being. But they quote me out of context. So according to me, the Home Office, after knowing the context, has given the exclusion order because I said that no Muslim should ever terrorize a single innocent human being. This is the crux. So if you quote the crux without the context, the main gist without the context, it's acceptable. But if you quote the sentence out of context and project a wrong meaning of what I want to convey, I feel it is not correct. So this was as far as the clarification. There is a video clipping, and this paragraph I've said in umpteen numbers of my lectures.
Every Muslim should be a terrorist to the robber. Whenever a robber sees a Muslim, he should be terrified. Whenever a rapist sees a Muslim, he should be terrified. Every Muslim should be a terrorist to each and every antisocial element. I'm aware that terrorist more commonly is used for a person who terrorizes an innocent person. In this context, no Muslim should even terrorize a single innocent human being.
So that was the clip from where they took the first reason, the first passage of my speech, why they've excluded me. As far as the second passage is concerned, I'm again reading from their letter. Inverted commas, they've quoted me. Beware of Muslims saying Osama bin Laden is right or wrong. I reject them. Dot, dot, dot. We don't know. But if you ask my view, if given the truth, if he's fighting the enemies of Islam, I'm for him. I don't know what he's doing. I'm not in touch with him. I don't know him personally. I read the newspaper. If he's terrorizing the terrorist, if he's terrorizing America, the terrorist, the biggest terrorist, he's following Islam. Source, YouTube, 2006. As you may be aware, that many journalists asked me regarding my view of Osama bin Laden, and due to the fact that he has been not convicted in respect of 9/11, and whenever I'm asked to verify the claims against him, I say that he's neither a saint, neither he's a terrorist. There's not a single statement of mine after 9/11 that has ever praised Osama bin Laden or supported any of his activities. With regards to the extract, what the Home Office has quoted, it is taken from a video on YouTube, and though it mentions their source, year 2006, I went onto the YouTube, and when I saw it, I realized it was a lecture of mine given in Singapore in 1998. It was 8 years before 2006, 3 years before the 9/11 attack. So now to attribute this statement of mine to 9/11 by the Home Office is unreasonable. And we made a presentation to the Home Office saying that this is a clip from the YouTube. It's absolutely manipulated. First of all, it's not of 2006. It is 1998. And if anyone sees, they can realize I'm much younger. Now also I'm young. but that time I was younger. And the venue was Singapore, you can make out from the audience. And if you check the records, I've never been to Singapore in 2006. It was a lecture given in 1998. And it was a clipping of some local organization put on the YouTube. We don't have the rushes. I don't know what has been changed, what has not been changed. Whether I said it or not, I don't know. But to claim it is said in 2006 and to attribute that I'm supporting is totally wrong. Because there are many of my lectures and question and sessions which has unequivocally condemned the acts of 9/11, 7/7, 7/11, and killing of all innocent human beings anywhere in the world. We'll go to the third reason or third passage why they have excluded me. I'm quoting, they said, that I said, how can you ever justify killing innocent people? But in the same breath, as condemning those responsible, we must also condemn those responsible for the deaths of thousands of innocent people in Iraq, Afghanistan and Lebanon. Brackets. As reported by the Manchester Evening News, 21st August 2006, as part of a speech you gave, that is I gave, at the Expo Islamia conference in Manchester. Now, I want to know what is wrong in this passage, whether it's quoted out of context or not. That will come to it later. What is wrong in me saying that how can you ever justify killing innocent people? But in the same breath, as condemning those responsible, we must also condemn those responsible for the deaths of thousands of innocent people in Iraq, Afghanistan and Lebanon. Do you mean to say that I cannot condemn those people who have killed the innocent people? It is not any people. My words are thousands of innocent people killed in Iraq, Afghanistan and Lebanon. Yet I went on the net and wanted to see what this article said. And when I went on the net, I was shocked that there was in the same newspaper, that is Manchester Evening News of 21st August 2006, before this paragraph that they quoted, there was another paragraph on top. And I read what it mentions. The same paragraph which they quoted, above that paragraph it said that, however, Dr. Zakir Naik described by organizers as, inverted commas, the most sought after Muslim public speaker in the world, unquote, criticized the actions of the New York, London, and Bombay bombers. And then I said, how can you justify killing innocent people? But in the same breath, as condemning those responsible, we must also condemn those responsible for the deaths of thousands of innocent people in Iraq, Afghanistan, and Lebanon. So when I'm condemning the 9/11, thousands of people killed in 9/11, more than 50 people killed in 7/7 in London, and about 200 people killed in Bombay on 7/11. In the same breath, I'm also condemning thousands of innocent people killed in Afghanistan, in Iraq, in Lebanon. Does it mean that if people are killed in America and UK, people should condemn those killers? Does it mean that the life of a UK citizen and an American citizen is more important than the life of an Afghani or an Iraqi or a Lebanese? So is this human rights? So why are they objecting on me condemning those people who have killed thousands of innocent people in Iraq, Afghanistan and Lebanon? So I leave it to the judgment of the press.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Ami Muhammad Hashim Madani. আর আপনারা দেখছেন পিস টিভি বাংলা।
পিস টিভি বাংলা, মানবতা সমাধান।
We go to the fourth paragraph, the fourth passage which they objected amongst the hundreds of talks I've given throughout the world. The inverted commas, they are saying that I said, strongest in enmity towards the Muslims are the Jews and the pagans. It, into bracket the Quran, does not say that the Muslims should fight with the Jews. The Jews by nature as a whole will be against Muslims. There are many Jews who are good to Muslims, but as a whole, the Quran tells us, as a whole, they will be our staunchest enemy. Peace TV, recorded on YouTube. And this is a passage that has been taken from one of the conferences we had in Bombay. That's in November 2007. The peace conference, which took place in Mumbai, and there was a French tourist who asked this question, and in reply to this question, I gave this answer. And if you hear the full clip, they are trying to say this was in reference to the verse of the Quran I quoted of Surah Maidah, chapter number 5, verse number 82, which says, "The strongest among men in enmity to the believers will thou find the Jews and the pagans. And nearest among them in love to the believers will thou find those who say we are Christians." So while I was quoting the verse of the Quran, I made this statement. And I went on further to clarify that this does not indicate that the Quran says that Muslims should fight the Jews. This is my explanation. The Jews by nature as a whole will be against Muslims. But there are many Jews who are good to Muslims. But as a whole, the Quran tells us that they will be the staunchest enemy to the believers. So this was explanation of the verse of the Quran, and which is self-explanatory, and we'll show you the clip of the complete answer that I gave in the conference. That's November 2007.
Can we have the clip?
I am traveling 8 months in India. I am 18 years old. I completed my 12 in June. And so, inshallah, if you agree, I will meet you in private. But now, I just would like to ask you about the Jews. Maybe if I am not wrong, you said that it is written in the Quran that Jews and pagans are the strong enemies of believers, Muslim believers, Muslim. And I would like to know how this verse can favorize peace in humankind, when we see the troubles between Palestine and Israel, how some Muslim and some Jews cannot misunderstand this verse, because maybe it can provoke some misinterpretation, or if it's literally that Jews and Muslims have to be enemies.
Well, that's a very good question. That he said, I said in my speech, and according to the verse of the Quran of Surah Maidah, chapter 5, verse 82, which says that strongest in enmity to the Muslims would be the Jews and the pagans, and the closest in love would be the Christians. So he's saying, won't it create enmity when they say that the Jews and the Muslims should fight? The Quran doesn't say Jews and the Muslims should fight. The Quran says strongest in enmity to the Muslims, to the believers, will be Jews. It does not say that Muslims should fight with the Jews. It doesn't say that. But it says that the Jews, by nature as a whole, they'll be against Muslims. And I told in my lecture, there are many Jews who accepted Islam. There are many Jews who are good to Muslims. But as a whole, if you take Jews as a whole and the Christians as a whole, the Christians are closer than the Jews as a whole. This is a fact. For example, the Quran says that the Jews are intelligent also. So that's a fact. If they're intelligent, they're intelligent. That doesn't mean that it hides the fact. And the Quran also says that they will be as a whole a staunchest enemy. So this is one of the falsification tests
that today, if you want to prove the Quran wrong, if the Jews get together, all of them, and they decide, let's prove the Quran wrong. At least for 3-4 years, we will be better than the Christians. Let's stop the war of Palestine. You know the Palestinians? The Jews were kicked out by Hitler. Hitler insinuated 6 million Jews. He kicked them out of Germany. The Arabs, the Palestinians, they do Alan Vasalan. Come with open arms. After a few years, they're kicked out of the home. Imagine someone gives the traveler his home to live, and the traveler kicks him out of his home, and he's shouting that he has taken my house, and you're calling them terrorists. So what they have to do is, let's get together and solve this problem. Whatever the problem is, today, America is controlled by the Jews, whether it be the banks, whether it be the money, whether it be the power. According to the American survey, no one can become a president of USA without walking the Star of David. So the Jews are a minority, less than 5% in America. But they're controlling the economy, they're controlling America. Fine? So if they're controlling America, let's solve the problem of Palestine, let's solve the American problem. Not forever, few years, 4-5 years only. And the problem is solved. So we aren't telling that the Muslims should fight with the Jews. In fact, the Quran says, even if your enemy wants peace, several places, even if they come to fight you, it's mentioned in Surah Anfal, in the battle, if they want peace, give it to them. So Quran is always for peace. Quran is always encouraging them. But if a person does not want peace to prevail, what can we do? Islam is a religion of peace. It wants peace, but it even mentions facts. That means we have to be careful of the Jews. Not that we have to fight them, unless they come and fight with you. That's a different thing. Imagine what's happening in Palestine, what's happening in other parts of the world. So brother, for peace to prevail, you have to follow the guidance of the Quran and live harmoniously rather than be enemies. So Quran doesn't say that Jews should be enemies, but they will be, saying. Hope that answers the question.
That was the complete context of the answer I gave. And many may be aware that very often I have always said that the biggest terrorist in human history is Adolf Hitler, who has done so many atrocities on the Jews. And it is claimed that he has incinerated 6 million Jews. So if I condemn the biggest terrorist in human history, Adolf Hitler, that means I'm not against the Jews. It is what I said was the statement of the Quran. So this was in relation to the 4 objections that were taken by the Home Office in UK. And what we are doing at present is that we have taken legal advice. We have legal opinion from here, mashallah, and also in UK. And what we are doing is that though there is no right to appeal, as was mentioned in the exclusion order, we are going to seek for a judiciary revision, what we call in our lingo writ petition. There's a judiciary revision in the High Court very soon. We have hired a battery of lawyers, barristers, and they are shocked. When I showed them the reasons, they are shocked that it is the first time we are seeing such an exclusion order based on these 4 passages. They are shocked at the decision taken by the new government, and they are very hopeful that it will be very easy unless the politicians intervene. Otherwise, I have more faith in the judicial system than the politicians in most part of the world. Whether it be judicial system of India or the judicial system of UK, I have more faith in the judicial system rather than the politicians. And I'm hopeful that inshallah, God willing, this exclusion order, inshallah, would be reversed.
Now we would have Advocate Majid Maimon speak to the press. Advocate Majid Maimon.
Dr. Zakir Naik Sahab, my friend Mahesh Bhai, other friends on the dais, and all my media friends. This is a special occasion where, after knowing the situation, I was constrained to leave the court and join this press conference. We have been fighting, particularly myself and Mahesh, but as 2 arms of human rights activists here, against all oppressive acts and orders that are being slapped onto people who are fundamentally or inherently weaker. And we always believe that justice can be delivered or ends of justice can be met if certain like-minded people throw their weight on the weaker side of the hand of the scale so that the scale is even. Now, Zakir Naik's disorder was seen by me this morning, and I am indeed sorry that I believe firmly even at this moment that United Kingdom is a civil society, a secular democracy, a new government in place, and it certainly upholds human dignity, human values, and adheres to the principles of equity, fairness, fair play, reasonableness, and principles of natural justice. If I am wrong, this order would be right. But I think I am right. I still believe that, yes, United Kingdom is a civil society which respects human dignity and human rights. When I look at this order, my friends, Mr. Naik has just now explained that how, with ill motivation, probably malice or vested interest, his quotes have been picked up from out of context, and he is labeled as a person probably dangerous to the civil society in UK. And that is how this sudden order has been handed down to him on the 17th of this month. Let me explain to you as a lawyer first, because when I see this order, I can't digest that a whole Department of Home in United Kingdom was unwise or rather rash in passing such an order. There are a number of fallacies in this order which I can enumerate in a matter of 3 minutes from here now. First, as Dr. Naik said, that the extracts that are relied upon to take this rigid decision, this harsh decision, are picked up out of context, A. B, you will be shocked to see this reality that this order has been passed on the 16th of June, handed down on 17th of June, forbidding him to travel on the 18th of June. Now, this shows that there was great hurry. I can understand that if this order had said that Dr. Naik, there is no time, and belatedly though, we have been informed about your nefarious or dangerous activities, therefore, we ask you stop, don't travel on 18th. I can understand that to some extent. But revoking his visa of 5 years, banning him, labeling him as a dangerous person, who would be, as they call it in their own phrase, revoking his visa of 5 years on the grounds that your exclusion from the UK would be conducive to the public good. Now, this blanket order revoking his visa is from no angle justified. I will just explain to you why. All the extracts which we see, as Zakir Saab said, that one of 1998, another of 2002, and two others of 2006. The last alleged attribution is of 2006. And you will be shocked, most of you may not know, that Zakir Naik was issued visa in July 2008. In July 2008, 15th of July precisely, 2008, your Home Department, your government, your machinery holds him to be entitled to a 5-year visit visa, which is valid till 15 July 2013. How is it that your department did not consider any of these attributions or these dangerous allegations against him whilst processing his visa in July 2008. On this ground itself, this order would be vitiated. This is one submission.
Ebadot amol korlei ki hoye jay, paben ki ja kichu korchen tai.
অবশ্যই নয়, যতক্ষণ না আমল এবাদত কবুল ও সংরক্ষণের শর্ত পূর্ণ হয়। জানতে হলে দেখুন আমার আলোচনা একমাত্র পিস টিভি বাংলায়।
বুঝুন সেই বিশিষ্ট নীতিমালা যার কারণে ইসলাম সারা বিশ্বে জনপ্রিয় হয়ে উঠেছে। দেখুন ইসলামের মৌলিক জ্ঞান প্রতি শনিবার রাত 8:30 বা পুনঃ সম্প্রচার সকাল 7:00 বাংলাদেশে পিস টিভি বাংলায়।
শান্ত
জীবন
যদি মানুষ ক্ষমা চায়
মহানবুল আলামিন
অবশ্যই অবশ্যই
ক্ষমা করে দিবেন।
আব্দুর রাজ্জাক বিন ইউসুফ, কাসিম বিন আব্বাস, মুজাফফর বিন মুহসিন, আকরামুজ্জামান বিন আব্দুল সালাম, ডক্টর আব্দুল্লাহ জাহাঙ্গীর, হারুন হোসেনের উপস্থাপনায় জানুন কিভাবে আমাদের ছোট বড় পাপ বয়ে আনে আমাদের অকল্যাণ। দেখুন পাপের অশুভ পরিণতি প্রতি বৃহস্পতিবার রাত 8:00 আর পুনঃ সম্প্রচার সকাল 6:30 বাংলাদেশে পিস টিভি বাংলায়।
I would also point out that look at the way the order has been passed and handed down. It is an ex parte order. It is a unilateral order. It's an order which has not given to the affected person even an opportunity to show cause. This is barbaric. This is inhuman. This is against the least principles of human dignity and human value and principles of natural justice. Why did you not ask him, Mr. Zakir Naik, look here, the time is less. Please don't travel on 18th. If possible, satisfy us before your schedule on the 18th or your speeches, programs, etc. a little later, so that we will consider in all fairness with an open mind as to whether you are in fact a dangerous person to UK society or not and give our verdict. Instead, they simply revoke his visa, which was granted to him otherwise, till 15 July 2013, which is definitely a very harsh and unreasonable order. Friends, now, there is non-application of mind in passing this order because, as I said, that this order is passed in June 2010, visa was granted in July 2008, the utterances were made much before that, and therefore, how do you justify your stand of 15 July 2008 vis-a-vis 16 June 2010? In a court of law, you will have no case. Number two, as I said, that you did not give him the opportunity to explain. Nowadays, you see, the communication has become so easy that in a matter of a couple of hours, an explanation could have been sought, an explanation could have been received, an explanation could have been examined in all fairness, and thereafter a just decision could have been taken. Now this is a decision which is per face so harsh, so unreasonable, so much without application of principles of natural justice and equity, that you have not only deprived him of his visit, which is his prerogative, you have not only used your discretion in a malafide way, but you have also tried to bring disrepute to a scholar without any just reasonable grounds or facts. Now, as I said, that, you see, if a man goes, suppose, assume hypothetically, that Zakir Naik had approached the UK Council office, are asking them that I have to go on the 18th for a program, then they may examine what are you going for, whether what you are going for is fair or unfair. And then refusing visa is one thing. But revoking an existing visa is too much. Please try to understand the two situations. The man was already having a valid visa, which was issued to him in July 2008, much after all the satanic allegations, as you want to say, which you can't explain, as Mr. Naik rightly said. And then the irony of this harsh order and it being so barbaric and totally betraying the least principles of a civil society is that it is not appealable. To err is human. Let this Secretary of State keep her mind open and let the department keep its mind open and gracefully consider that if we have erred, we are subject to correction. You have erred on facts, you have erred on law, you have erred on your principles, and you have erred on practically all fronts. And yet if you insist that no, our orders are divine orders, they cannot be looked into by any other human being or any other organization or authority, I'm afraid this is a terrorism, an act of terrorism. I would say this is terror. I'm sure Zakir will approach whichever forum, the appellate authority, be it a court, be it a diplomatic authority, either through the Indian embassy, our external affairs ministry, and if we can argue here, even before S.M. Krishna, our external affairs minister, and point out that kindly see here, we don't want to cross sword with United Kingdom for various reasons. We have got good relations with that country. We keep cordial relations with them. This should not serve as a pill of bitterness between the two countries. Our relations are not going to be affected. It's a matter of principle. It's a question of human dignity. We are just telling Zakir Naik's this rash order whether it can stand the scrutiny of a rational mind. And the points which I have argued, I think even before a small judge with little sense of justice would hear these points, we will not take a minute to set aside this order. And I'm sure that Zakir would succeed. We don't have to say anything. Well, we would still say that it's your innocent error. Please rectify it. Please correct it so that we don't have any damage to our perception that UK society is a civil society committed to the principles of natural justice, equity and fair play. Thank you very much.
May I request Mr. Mahesh Bhatt to move in the center. Mr. Mahesh Bhatt is a noted activist for so many years on any human rights violation and such cases. And when the whole society is on one side, he feels that someone is being unjust with him. Even if that person is alone, he is standing out for justice. Mr. Mahesh Bhatt.
Well, at the onset, let me salute Dr. Zakir Naik for daring to lock horns with the mighty empire, the British Empire, and challenging their arrogance. I'm glad that we have an Indian who's not timid and who's not going to take these insults that they're hurling at us day in and day out lying down. So I salute his audacity, which comes from his iman, from his the truth which is there in every pore of his being. It is that that makes him stand up and say things to the bully the way it is. If he had any gray spot in his heart, he wouldn't have risked locking horns with these bullies who have the means and the power to lock you in and throw away the keys. Human history has been a witness to unspeakable deeds of barbarism that have been unleashed by the Western nations against the world. Ladies and gentlemen, these are dangerous times. The world is becoming the most entertained and the least informed world. I thought the United States was the most entertained and the least informed. But slowly and surely, the world is catching up and India is not far behind. I think we as Indians owe it to our brother, who is our national pride, who is a prized treasure, that we ask those who accuse him to look at the facts sanely, and as Majid Bhai says, to err is human. Maybe an individual there has erred. We do not want to put the entire nation into the dock for the misdeeds of a handful of people. We cannot reduce human beings to stereotypes. We cannot reduce a nation or a community to a single story. Because when we do that, we do the same mistake what they have done. They call Dr. Naik a warmonger. Well, history knows who is the warmonger. The Western nations, the United States, backed with the United Kingdom, did not give a tinker's damn for the world opinion and bombarded Iraq when the UN was screaming that you don't have evidence that there are weapons of mass destruction. What happened thereafter? You killed people, shed blood. And what did you find there? No evidence to say that there was any weapons of mass destruction. So are you going to believe in the opinions of those people who have the means to lie, buy wordsmiths, get newspapers, have television networks on their side to market their lies and hang a man like Dr. Naik? I would say no. It is the same United States of America when it bombarded Afghanistan. They bombed Al Jazeera because Al Jazeera was bringing you images of the bloodshed of the people of Afghanistan. It is not my opinion. It was Howard Zinn, an extraordinary American who had the courage to point out to the world that it was the United States of America that bombarded the television network of Al Jazeera because Al Jazeera was bringing images to the world showing how the people of Afghanistan were suffering. Are we going to become victims of these people who decide at the drop of the hat whom they're going to call terrorists and whom they're not going to call terrorists? I think no. I stand squarely behind my brother, and I stand behind every such person who doesn't take the opinion which are dished out by governments to suit their politics. The first law of journalism, sir, is governments lie. And as responsible journalists, it's your duty to not become victims of state propaganda. The world has suffered enormously for the last 10 years because all responsible journalists, including you, lapped up what was dished out to you by them. If you do not have the means to question it, say, I don't know. It is more decorous for a man to say, I don't know. A person who knows that he does not know can be thought. There is humility. But a person who does not know and pretends that he knows can do enormous harm. So I think as responsible people of the media, it is your duty to your fellow human being, to your fellow Indian, who stands here with dignity, that he gets a fair deal. And it's not fitting for the nation and a government who stands up for a celebrity like Shah Rukh Khan when he has come into trouble in the United States. They must also stand up for Dr. Zakir Naik and plead his case. That's all I have to say. Thank you.
Thank you for your very comprehensive and apt comments on the legal side as well as the humanitarian side of the issue. We now throw the floor open for the many journalists here, I see many senior faces, to put forward their question. May I request you to kindly make the question brief and to the point and restrict it to the issue because of the limited time available. And to whom the question is, if it's to Dr. Zakir Naik, Advocate Majid Memon, or Mr. Mahesh Bhatt, kindly specify and kindly state your name and which media organization you represent so they can give you a more appropriate response.
আমরা অনেক গুনাহের কাজ করি দিনে আর রাতে সকাল আর সন্ধ্যায় জেনে আর না জেনে কিন্তু কিছু গুনাহ রয়েছে কবিরা যা আল্লাহ সুবহানাহু ওয়া তাআলা তওবা করা ছাড়া ক্ষমা করে দেবেন না
শাহ ওয়ালিউল্লাহ
কিন্তু বন্ধু জানেন কোনটি কবিরা গুনাহ বেঁচে থাকতে চান কবিরা গুনাহ থেকে তাহলে যোগ দিন আমার সাথে পিএস টিভি বাংলায়
দেখুন বড় গুণা প্রতি সোমবার ও শনিবার সন্ধ্যা 5:30 বা পুনঃ সম্প্রচার সকাল 6:00 বাংলাদেশে পিএস টিভি বাংলায়।
Peace TV Bangla, মানবতা সমাধান।
The Muhammad Wajihuddin from the Times of India.
Okay, you have identified, welcome. You have already identified me, so I don't need to waste time. Okay, Dr. Zakir Naik, you very beautifully clarified the context in which you said you talked about the Muslims being terrorists. Now you were talking about a police officer who was a terror to those anti-social elements. Now, do you think that now you could have rephrased those terms, because this is not the first time? It has been on the blog, it has been on the internet, it has been on the television, in various articles. Now, the second question is, do you think that by banning your entry to the United Kingdom, as the Indian Express editorial pointed out yesterday, perhaps they have given you a big megaphone to tell the world that, oh, here I am and I have been victimized? Thank you very much.
What is the second part of the question?
About your ban on the UK visa, revoking your visa. So perhaps they have given you a big platform to tell the world, that, you know, use the media and tell the world, like this press conference, which will go to the world, then now I am being victimized. Another Muslim is being victimized, okay?
Brother Vajudin asked two questions. The first one, that seeing the context, should I say, in the context of a policeman, that he is a terrorist to the criminal, should I use it for the Muslims? Using it only by itself is wrong. Therefore, though I've used it many times, I always go ahead to say that I'm aware that a terrorist more commonly is used for a person who terrorizes an innocent human being. In this context, no Muslim should ever be a terrorist. If I say along with it, no problem. But if I only use this without mentioning that terrorist is more commonly used for a person who terrorizes innocent human beings, it is wrong. So therefore, whenever I mention this, I say it in context. And as far as the second question is concerned, that do I agree with the news of the Indian Express that the UK government has given me a megaphone to say that any Muslim is banned? I believe more in the verse of the Quran, of Surah Al-Imran, chapter 3, verse number 54, which says, "Makaru makar Allah, wallahu khairul makirin." They planned and plotted, Allah too planned. Allah is the best of planners. It is not they who have given me a megaphone. It is they plan to ban me, and I have faith in my creator, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who will see to it that the more they try to suppress my voice, inshallah, more louder it will be. And having people like Mr. Mahesh Bhatt and
Adhika Majid. In addition to that, sorry.
My views I'm giving. You may agree with my view, you may disagree with my view. If you don't agree with my view, so you're asking my view. So in that way, what they have done, they have made one of the biggest mistakes. And what Adhika Majid Maimon said, that any lawyer, even a layman, if he reads this, he knows that it will not stand any chances. And whatever he said, he just read in the morning. Same way, I've been advised that we are looking for the time when we have the case challenged in the UK High Court. We are looking forward for it. We are looking forward for it.
Okay. And now, you know, why don't you leave it to Allah only? And, you know, instead of fighting for your entry to United Kingdom, because United Kingdom, as far as I know, that is not a place that every Muslim must visit. It's not like Mecca or Medina that you have to visit at least once in a lifetime. Another thing is that this is the prerogative of a country to allow a person, not to allow him. So why you are challenging that? Why don't you just sit and say, okay, we'll just wait?
Again, there are two questions asked by Brother Muhammad Wajuddin. First question, why don't you leave it to Allah alone? Why do you want to enter? Our beloved Prophet Muhammad said, when a person asked him, I have a camel, should I trust in Allah and leave my camel? Or should I tie my camel and trust in Allah? So the Prophet replied, tie your camel and trust in Allah. So I'm following the commandments of my Prophet. Trust in Allah by tie a camel. That doesn't mean that if I'm sick, as I believe in Allah, I won't go to a doctor. Because Quran says, first alu ahali zikri in kumtu la talamun. Surah Nahal chapter 16 verse 43. If you don't know, ask the person who's an expert. So in the lawyer is an expert. So not that if UK bans me, that I will not be able to speak. But coming to your second question, that they have a prerogative to allow me or not to allow me, I agree with you. They have a right to allow or disallow any human being who's a non-UK to enter. But giving me permission in 2008, I've been going since the past 15 years. I have given several lectures in most of the major cities of UK, in London, in Birmingham, in Bradford, in Cardiff, in Glasgow, in Manchester, and tens of thousands of people attending. Even after giving me a valid visa,
last visa that they gave me was 2008, valid for 5 years. It yet has 3 years validity. To exclude that, it is against the human rights. And I have a right to enter, and that also maligning me. One is preventing me from entering, one thing. That's one thing which is not that much of a problem for me. Without going to UK, I can go in many other ways, I can have my voice registered. But maligning me, saying that I am a person who's a hate monger, I am a person who promotes terrorism, that is a bigger issue for me than entering UK. And hopefully we'll reverse both. And it is the right of the citizens of UK to hear me. It is the right of the citizens of UK in tens of thousands want to hear me. Why are you depriving them of hearing me live? When they've had one of the best arenas or biggest arenas they've had in UK and they want to hear me, it is their right that they have to hear me. That's the reason I feel that the order will be revoked.
Any other question? We'll give chance only one or two questions to every newspaper. Otherwise, at the limit given to me for time, will not be able to be managed. Yes, sister.
A couple of things. One, between 2000...
Can we have your name and the newspaper you represent?
I'm Arifa from the Hindustan Times. Between 2008 and till now, how many times have you visited the UK? And also, the YouTube video was attributed to 2006, but you're saying it was in 1998, before 9/11. But in 1998, you were aware and you were talking about Osama bin Laden and his activities. I mean, I don't know how many people were aware of Osama bin Laden's activities in 1998.
Since I got the visa 2008, how many times have I traveled? I've traveled twice. Once in 2008 and once in 2009. And a couple of days back, I was supposed to travel the third time. As far as the second question is concerned, was I aware about Osama bin Laden in 1998? Believe me, not as much as I'm aware now. The name had just appeared. And as a general, if you hear, a Muslim should not malign anyone without, because the Quran says in Surah Hujurat, chapter 49, verse number 6, whenever you get information, check it up before passing on third person. So when a Muslim condemned me, I said, you cannot condemn anyone without proof. That's the reason I said, I don't know him. I don't know whether he's responsible. I don't say he's good or whether he's bad. But naturally, I did not know him. Now, also, I don't know him. But the media has given me information, which again, whether right or wrong, is to be discussed later on. But I do agree with you that it was 1998. So you cannot attribute this statement of mine to the 9/11, which took place 3 years back.
All the extracts are pre-July 2008. You must note that.
Yes.
The next question from the sister. Yes.
My name is Kavita. I'm with the Indian Express. My question is to Dr. Naik. There was a group of Muslims who went to the Deputy High Commission yesterday. They were led by the Raza Academy and they supported the decision to exclude you. What would you say to that?
Every person who is popular, who is famous, has some people against him. And the best example, a beloved Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, not only according to Muslims, even according to non-Muslim Michael H. Hart, Prophet Muhammad is the most influential human being in history according to Michael H. Hart. He wrote a book on 100 most influential people in the world. And number one, he rated Prophet Muhammad. But today, the maximum books written against any human being in the world, it is Prophet Muhammad. So similarly, because of my popularity, everyone may not agree with my view. So there are people who may disagree, and they have a right to disagree. I'm not saying everyone should agree with my view.
Yes, brother.
Akshay Deshmani from DNA. Hi. I've been reading the British press now, so I don't know how much of this information that I'm putting through is true, but then based on that, I think it was the Times which reported this, Times London or some such paper. The newspaper report argued was that your views on controversial personalities like Salman Rushdie and the author of Lajja being Taslima Nasreen. Now, your views on them have been, quite unpopular in the sense that you have supported the bans on them. Now, this is what the article argued. Now, if this is true, how would you respond to that? And now you're arguing for your own rights to freedom of speech.
This I'm going to discuss in detail in my third lecture in UK, that's in Birmingham, Freedom of Expression and Islamic Perspective. As I gave a reply to Brother Muhammad Wajuddin when he said that UK government has a right to prevent me from coming, but they have no right to malign me. Fine. So that is freedom of expression, but not freedom of maligning anyone. The same way when someone maligns anyone without proof, that's the reason someone maligns, he should be put straight. So if the UK government is maligning me, we'll fight it in the court. Again, the word fight, you know what fight, we'll challenge it, the right word. Someone says, I'm going to fight UK. So there'll be another man that Zakir wants to fight UK. I want to challenge the UK government. You have to be in choice of words. Find challenge in the court. So similarly, if someone says some malign someone without proof, etc., and criticizes, the Quran and Islam says in Surah Hujurat, chapter 49, verse number 11 and 12, it is prohibited. So in that context, I said, I agree when someone maligns or criticizes or speaks bad about someone without proof, etc., then he should be stopped.
May we allow questions to the other media, you know? We have a lot of English media asking questions. Anyone else? You have got a question? Can you speak in the mic so we can hear clearly? Aapka introduction, aapka naam aur
kaun se... I'm Wasim Sarat, Sara TV. We just want to know what the whole problem was. Tell us a little bit in Hindi. And the other thing is to know you. कि आप ऑलरेडी पहले भी जा चुके हैं तो क्यों आप पे खास करके बैन लगाया गया है, इसे थोड़ा सा हिंदी में बताइएगा।
बाइट ले रहा है। मेरी हिंदी और उर्दू इतनी फंसी नहीं है, लेकिन मैं जवाब दूंगा। भाई साहब ने सवाल पूछा कि ये सब मसला क्या था और क्यों हुआ। मैं यूके इंग्लैंड में जाने वाला था और मेरा प्रोग्राम तय हुआ था तीन प्रोग्राम बड़े एरिना में, 25, 26 और 27 जून को शेफील्ड एरिना, शेफील्ड के अंदर वेमली अरीना लंदन में और बर्मिंगहम एलजी अरीना एनईसी में। ये तीन प्रोग्राम तय हो चुके थे और काफ़ी पब्लिसिटी हो चुकी थी उस वक्त। तकरीबन एक महीने पहले 30 मई एक यूके न्यूज़पेपर है जिसका नाम है टाइम्स, जो संडे को संडे टाइम्स में एक जर्नलिस्ट डेविड लेपर्ड, उनने एक आर्टिकल लिखा क्या एक हेट मॉन्गो को ब्रिटेन में आने की इजाज़त दी गई है। एक आदमी जो दहशत और जो नफरत फैलाता है उसे ब्रिटेन में आने की इजाज़त दी गई है, और वो अटैक था गवर्नमेंट की तरफ। क्या नहीं, गवर्नमेंट जो कहती है कि गलत लोग को एंट्री नहीं देंगे, डॉक्टर जाकिर नायक को कैसी दे रही है। और मेरे बहुत से तकरीर के कुछ सेंटेंसेस को तोड़ मोड़ के पेश किया गया है मीडिया में। मिसाल के तौर पर कहा गया है कि जाकिर कहता है कि हर मुसलमान दहशतगर्द होना चाहिए, जो आउट ऑफ कॉन्टेक्स्ट है। और मैंने कॉन्टेक्स्ट दिया कि मैंने कहा दहशतगर उसे कहते हैं जो एक इंसान के दिल में दहशत पैदा करता है। मिसाल के तौर पे जब एक चोर पुलिस को देखता है तो चोर के दिल में दहशत पैदा होती है, तो उस चोर के लिए वो पुलिसमैन दहशतगर्द है। उसी कॉन्टेक्स्ट में हर मुसलमान, जब भी कोई चोर या कोई गैरकानूनी काम करने वाला इंसान कोई मुसलमान को देखता है तो उसके दिल में दहशत पैदा होना चाहिए, इस कॉन्टेक्स्ट में हर मुसलमान दहशतगर्द होना चाहिए। लेकिन मैंने ये भी कहा कि आम तौर पे दहशतगर्द उसे कहते हैं जो एक मासूम इंसान के दिल में दहशत पैदा करता है, और इस कॉन्टेक्स्ट में कोई भी मुसलमान एक भी मासूम इंसान के दिल में दहशत नहीं पैदा करना चाहिए। तो ये आउट ऑफ कॉन्टेक्स्ट कोट करके मुझे बदनाम किया जा रहा था, और ये गवर्नमेंट के ऊपर प्रेशर था कि अभी लेक्चर होने वाला है और वो जानते थे कि मैं 18 जून को निकलने वाला हूँ। तो इट इज़ मोर ऑफ अ पॉलिटिकल डिसीजन, ये एक सियासी डिसीजन है, इट इज़ नॉट अ लीगल डिसीजन। जिस तरीके से एडवोकेट मजीद मेमन साहब ने कहा कि ये लीगल डिसीजन नहीं था, सियासी डिसीजन था, उन पर दबाव था कि अभी नई गवर्नमेंट 1.5 महीने में आई, तो इट्स अ पॉलिटिकल डिसीजन विच इंशाल्लाह दे विल रिपेंट, जो वो इस डिसीजन के लिए पछताएंगे। और हम इंशाल्लाह इसे चैलेंज करने वाले हाई कोर्ट यूके के अंदर, और हमें उम्मीद है कि जो जुडिशी सिस्टम है, जो जुडिशी सिस्टम यूके की है, हमें उन पे और भरोसा है बनिस्बत सियासी सिस्टम पे, और हम इसे चैलेंज करेंगे। और उम्मीद है कि इस एक्सक्लूजन ऑर्डर को जो मुझे आने से रोका गया है उसे रिवर्स करेंगे इंशाल्लाह, उसे पलटाएंगे।
अस्सलामु अलैकुम, आमी मोहम्मद बदरुद्दोजा नदवी, आपनारा देखछेन पीस टीवी बांग्ला।
बंदार उपर आल्लाहर अधिकार, মানুষের প্রতি মানুষের অধিকার, জীবজন্তুর অধিকার। আমি মোহাম্মদ হাশিম মাদানী, আপনারা দেখছেন পিস টিভি বাংলা।
শেখ হাশিম মাদানী
কিভাবে ইসলাম বিভিন্ন সৃষ্টিকে অধিকার দিয়ে ওদের সুরক্ষিত করেছে জানার জন্য দেখুন ইসলামী অধিকার।
দেখুন অধিকার সমূহ প্রতি মঙ্গলবার সন্ধ্যা 5টায় আর পুনঃ সম্প্রচার রাত 12টায় বাংলাদেশে পিস টিভি বাংলায়।
कई बार देखा गया डॉक्टर साहब कि आपने जो स्पीच दी थी लादेन को लेके या आतंकवादी दहशत के खिलाफ दी थी, उन्हें वो समझने में नाकाम रहे या आप उन्हें समझाने में, क्या था जरा मसला आप समझाइए।
नहीं, समझाने में बिल्कुल कामयाब रहा, लेकिन जो लोग नहीं चाहते कि जाकिर की आवाज सुनी जाए वो कुछ मेरे आंसर को तोड़ मोड़ के पेश करते हैं। समझने में कोई भी आम इंसान समझेगा, बेसिक, ही डजंट हैव टू बी तालीम याफ्ता। लेकिन जो लोग खिलाफ है, क्योंकि मैं अमन की आवाज फैलाता हूँ और जो लोग दहशतगर्द है उनके खिलाफ बात करता हूँ, तो जो दहशत फैलाना चाहते हैं और वो जानते हैं कि जाकिर एकदम वोकल है और बिल्कुल हक के बारे में बात करेगा, वो लोग चाहते हैं कि मेरी आवाज को दबाए और मेरे कुछ सेंटेंस को लेके तोड़ मोड़ के पेश करते और दिखाना चाहते हैं कि मैं गलत इंसान हूँ।
लेकिन वो पूरा सेंटेंस क्या था, वो जरा सेंटेंस जरा क्लियर कीजिए।
सेंटेंस तो मैंने कह दिया, टेररिस्ट का थिंग कह चुका, हिंदी में कह चुका ना,
आपके पास दिया है ना,
वो उसमें दिया गया,
नोट में, प्रेस रिलीज में सब लिखे हैं।
आपके खिलाफ कौन है, आप इसको जानते का जैसे कि कुछ ऐसे लोग हैं जो आपका आपकी आवाज नहीं सुनना चाहते हैं वहां पे, तो कौन आपके खिलाफ है, वहां की गवर्नमेंट है कि वहां के टेररिस्ट हैं या कोई लोग?
मैं समझता हूं कि जैसा मैंने कहा, क्योंकि मैं कहता हूं कि जो भी मासूम इंसानों की जान लेने में मदद करता है वो मेरे हिसाब से दहशतगर्द है। और जिस तरीके से मैंने कहा, मेरे स्टेटमेंट में जो ऑब्जेक्शन लिया, मैंने कहा कि जो हज़ारों बेगुनाह लोग अफगानिस्तान में मरे, इराक में मरे, लेबनान में मरे, वो लोग जिन्होंने इनको मारा वो लोग को कंडेम करना चाहिए, उसके ऊपर ऑब्जेक्शन लिए। तो मैं ये पूछना चाहता हूँ, अगर मैं कह रहा हूँ कि मैंने ये नहीं कहा कि आम लोग, मासूम लोग, हज़ारों की तादाद में जो अफगानिस्तान, इराक और लेबनान में मारे गए, जिनने उन्हें मारा उनको कंडेम करता हूँ, तो गवर्नमेंट को उसके खिलाफ मुझे एक्शन लेना चाहिए। अभी आप ही मुझे कहिए क्या ये सही है क्या गलत है। लेकिन उसके साथ साथ मैंने ये भी कहा कि अमेरिका में 9/11 में हज़ारों लोग मारे गए वो भी गलत है, यूके के लंदन के अंदर 50 से ज़्यादा ट्रेन बॉम्ब में मारे गए वो भी गलत है, और बॉम्बे में तकरीबन 200 लोग जो मारे गए वो भी गलत है। उसके बाद मैंने कहा कि जो मासूम लोग अफगानिस्तान में मारे गए वो भी गलत है, इराक में, तो उसके ऊपर उनको ऑब्जेक्शन है। अभी क्यों ऑब्जेक्शन है हम कोर्ट में इंशाल्लाह फैसला करेंगे। जहां तक कि लोग पूछते ओसामा बिन लादेन के बारे में, मैं कहता हूं कि अगर मैं बीबीसी और सीएनएन को देखूंगा और उसे सच मानूंगा तो मुझे मानने पड़ेगा कि ओसामा बिन लादेन टेररिस्ट है। लेकिन क्योंकि मैं दुनिया भर घूमता हूँ, मुझे कई रिपोर्ट्स मिलते हैं, और चंद साल पहले 7 सितंबर 2006 में टाइम्स ऑफ इंडिया में एक रिपोर्ट आई थी कि 75 साइंटिस्ट दे कंसिडर 9/11 टू बी एन इनसाइड जॉब। इनसाइड जॉब उर्दू में क्या कहेंगे, हिंदी में अंदरूनी मामला, अंदर की बात। और उसमें लिखा था कि 75 अमेरिकन साइंटिस्ट एंड प्रोफेसर वो कहते हैं के चंद वॉर मॉन्गर्स, सम वॉर मॉन्गर्स इन व्हाइट हाउस आर रिस्पॉन्सिबल फॉर द 9/11 सो दैट दे कैन टेक कंट्रोल एंड इन्वेड ऑयल रिच कंट्रीज। कौन कह रहा है, जाकिर नाइक ने? टाइम्स ऑफ इंडिया ऑफ बॉम्बे इज रिपोर्टिंग 75 साइंटिस्ट एंड प्रोफेसर अमेरिकन जो कहते हैं कि उनके ख्याल से, उनके नजरिए से ये लोग, कुछ चंद लोग व्हाइट हाउस में ये 9/11 किए और ताकि वो ऑयल रिच कंट्रीज के ऊपर कब्जा कर सके। मैंने कई डीवीडीज देखे, लूज चेंज, 9/11 फारेनहाइट, कई डीवीडीज। जब मैं देखता हूँ, मैं क्योंकि डॉक्टर हूँ, मैं साइंस में मानता हूँ, जब मैं साइंटिस्ट की दलील देखता हूँ मुझे लगता है ये दलील बीबीसी और सीएनएन से काफ़ी ज़्यादा पावरफुल है। लेकिन फिर भी, क्योंकि कुरान मुझे कहता है कि जब भी इंफॉर्मेशन आए चेक करो, तो ये इन्फॉर्मेशन कुछ और कह रही है, वो कुछ, तो आम पब्लिक जब मुझसे पूछती है या प्रेस मुझसे पूछती है तो मैं कहता हूँ मैं बिन लादेन के बारे में नहीं जानता हूँ, मैं ना उसका दोस्त हूँ ना उसका दुश्मन हूँ। मैं ये भी नहीं कह सकता हूँ कि वो दहशतगर्द है, ये भी नहीं कह सकता हूँ वो संत है, मैं नहीं जानता हूँ। और मैं ये कहता हूँ और मैंने कह चुका हूँ, ये मैं पूछना चाहता हूँ होम सेक्रेटरी टेरेसा मे से, सपोज मिसाल के तौर पर हाइपोथेटिकली आज आप ओसामा बिन लादेन को पकड़ती है यूके गवर्नमेंट और उसके अगेंस्ट सुनाई होती हाई कोर्ट में, हाई कोर्ट की सुनाई होने वाली 4-5 दिन बाद, और उस हाई कोर्ट के जज को अगर टेरेसा मे पूछेंगी आपके ख्याल से ओसामा बिन लादेन टेररिस्ट है क्या नहीं, तो क्या कहेगा वो, क्या कहेगा? मैं नहीं जानता हूँ, पहला भाई ट्रायल तो चलने दो, मैं एविडेंस को देखूंगा फिर कहूंगा। वो थोड़ी कहेगा नहीं बीबीसी में देख चुका हूँ, ट्रायल मत करो, उसको मौत के घर उतार दो। नहीं, क्योंकि वो जो जज है
वो एक अच्छा नागरिक है, वो रिस्पॉन्सिबल है। उसी तरीके से अल्हम्दुलिल्लाह मेरी 10 करोड़ से ज़्यादा फॉलोइंग है और जो मैं कहता हूँ लोग सुनते हैं, मानते हैं। इसीलिए मुझे चौकन्ना रहना चाहिए। जब मैं दोनों न्यूज़ देखता हूँ तो मैं कहता हूँ आई डोंट नो। और जिस तरीके से महेश भट्ट साहब ने कहा, आई डोंट नो बोलना बेटर है रादर देन गिव अ रॉन्ग कमेंट। और इस्लाम के अंदर भी अगर मैं किसी को गलत इल्ज़ाम लगाता हूँ तो मेरे पे गुनाह होगा। किसी की तारीफ करने को प्रॉब्लम नहीं, वो इंसान अच्छा भी नहीं बोलूँ अच्छा है तो प्रॉब्लम नहीं है, लेकिन किसी पे इल्ज़ाम लगाने के लिए तहकीक करना चाहिए। और ना मुझे तहकीक करने के लिए टाइम है, मैं क्यों मेरा वक्त बर्बाद करूँ। जिसके पास प्रूफ है वो कहे मुझे कोई एतराज, मेरे पास प्रूफ नहीं है। जब मैं दोनों प्रूफ देखता हूँ मैं कहता हूँ आई डोंट नो, नीदर डू आई कॉल हिम अ सेंट, नीदर डू आई कॉल हिम अ टेररिस्ट। लेकिन लोग क्या करिए, हाँ जाकिर ने कहा बिन लादेन टेररिस्ट नहीं है और उसको छाप देंगे, आप भी छाप यहाँ से भी। मैंने कहा ही वॉज नॉट अ सेंट नॉर अ टेररिस्ट। तो लोग ऐसा तोड़ मोड़ के पेश करते, ना मेरा दोस्त है ना मेरा दुश्मन है।
अच्छा अच्छा, विल अलाउ द लास्ट क्वेश्चन फ्रॉम ब्रदर जाकिर टू ब्रदर जाकिर, जाकिर टू जाकिर, यस वेलकम, कैन वी हैव द माइक गिवन टू द ब्रदर द बैक, यस यस ब्रदर।
माय नेम इज जाकिर सर एंड आई एम वर्किंग फॉर सफर मुंबई का हिंदी प्रेस एक्चुअली, एंड आई हर्ड मेनी टाइम अबाउट हिज स्पीचेस एंड ऑल, वेरी गुड, ही हैज ट्रैवल्ड ऑल ओवर द वर्ल्ड। I cannot understand why only London has only these people have only banned his visa and no other countries. Why all these famous personalities are being attacked? I don't know what is the reason. Are these people, foreign people, are allergic to Indian famous personality, or are they scared with these people that one person is giving such a better speech and all, and but still he is attacked and all this. So what will happen about a simple person like me? Ordinary person, what will happen, sir? At least you are there to support this person. He is a famous personality. What happened? There are many Indians who are suffering like this. What is happening, sir? Are these foreign people really scared of Indian people? He is not bombarding anything. He is just giving the simple speech along with the Quran he is reciting it all. Why all these things happening with the Indian personality? Because before that also, our army general will be refused the visa. So all these famous personalities are being, the foreign people are scared of this famous personality.
We asked brother,
I want to ask Majid, the London Maiman, London people also, thank you, why brother they have Zakir, done these things, sir.
Thank you brother Zakir. May I request brother Majid Maiman to
this is truly another Zakir, nothing more.
Zakir ka maana hai truth ko spread karna.
हमने देखिए कानूनी तौर पर मैं पहले ही कह चुका हूँ, मैं दोहरा दूँ हिंदी में भी, बेचारे वो कुछ लोग कह रहे थे। देखिए ऐसा है कि ये 17 जून को इनको एक पर्ची दे दी गई और ये कहा गया कि आप 18 जून को इंग्लैंड नहीं आ सकते, आपको रोक दिया जाएगा, आपका वीज़ा रद्द कर दिया गया। ये एक बहुत ही गैर जिम्मेदार हुक्म है जिसके खिलाफ, जैसा कि जाकिर साहब ने बताया शुरुआत में और हमने भी उनको कहा कि हम पूरी ताकत से इसको सपोर्ट करेंगे कि इसके खिलाफ जहां भी उच्च न्यायालय के सामने वहां पर या जहां कहीं गवर्नमेंट के डिप्लोमेटिक ऑफिस में इसके खिलाफ अपील करना ज़रूरी है। हालांकि इस ऑर्डर में लिखा गया है कि दिस इज़ अ नॉन अपीलेबल ऑर्डर। अब ये मेकिंग इट नॉन अपीलेबल ऑर्डर, ए रैश ऑर्डर विच इज़ हैंडेड ओवर इन अ डे, यूनिलैटरली एक्स पार्टी, यानी बगैर नोटिस दिए, बगैर वजह पूछे आप एक तरफा एक ऑर्डर देते हैं, और उसके बाद जब आप ये कहते हैं कि ये नॉन अपीलेबल ऑर्डर है, तो मैंने कहा, मैं दोहरा दूंगा, दिस इज़ टेरर, ये है टेररिस्ट एक्ट। यानी इस तरह से कोई कानून में कोई बात बैठती नहीं कि आप तो
आपको ये बैन कर देंगे
जी, आप ऐसा है कि नहीं, आप अगर भाई ठीक है जाकिर साहब आप 18 को नहीं आ सकते हैं, ये कहा होता उन्होंने, क्योंकि वक्त कम है, चलिए हम आपको मौका देते हैं और आप हमारे साथ बैठें और बताएं कि आपका वीज़ा क्यों ना कैंसिल किया जाए, that would have been at least fair. Then Zakir would have gone, he would have explained his stand, ke bhai kya sahi hai kya galat hai, main kitna khatarnak hu ya main kitna hi safe aadmi hu, ho sakta tha mamla. Uske baad agar jo koi order hota to wo mana jata tha. Is order mein kai sari khamiyan hain, humne bataya. Iski sabse badi khami humne ye batayi ke isme 3 ya 4 extract jo diye gaye hain wo 2002 aur 2006 ke hain. 2008 15 जुलाई को इन्होंने वीज़ा ग्रांट किया है। हम यही सबसे पहला सवाल पूछेंगे अदालत के सामने भी या कहीं भी कि 15 जुलाई 2008 को जब इन्होंने एक 5 साल के लिए विजिट वीज़ा आपने दिया था, उस वक्त तो ये पहले कह चुके थे, उस वक्त उन्हें क्यों नहीं रोका? उसके बाद 2008 में इन्होंने विजिट की, 2009 में इन्होंने विजिट की, 2010 में अचानक इस तरह से आपका सख्ती से उनके तरफ रवैया देना सिर्फ साफ जाहिर होता है कि इसकी वजूहात कागजात पर ये नहीं है, इसकी वजूहात कुछ और होंगी। ये एक बड़ा बहुत मुद्दा है। दूसरा ये एक्सपर्टीजा वैसे 15 जुलाई 2008 को इशू किया गया मल्टीपल विजिट के लिए और ये 15 जुलाई 2013 तक के वैलिड था और कोई वजह नहीं थी कि इसे इस तरह से रद्द किया जाए। तो इसकी हार्शनेस, इसकी अनरीजनेबलनेस, इसकी अनफेयरनेस के बारे में बहुत सारा कुछ कहा जा सकता है। दूसरा एज आई सेड कि नो कॉज इज आस्क फॉर, जाकिर से आप कहते, मैंने जैसा कहा पहले भी कि आज कम्युनिकेशन इतना फास्ट है कि एक कम्युनिकेशन टेलीफोन के जरिए या ईमेल के जरिए फौरन उनसे पूछ लेते कि जाकिर साहब हम सोच रहे हैं कि हम आपको 18 तारीख से आने के लिए रोक दें, आपको क्या कहना है इसके बारे में। ये कुछ कह देते कि भाई इन वजूहात से हम रोक रहे हैं, उन वजूहात का एक्सप्लेनेशन जैसा अभी आपके सामने दिया। मैं समझता हूँ कोई भी ओपन माइंडेड आदमी होगा जिसमें थोड़ा सा भी सेंस ऑफ जस्टिस होगा वो कहता है कि हाँ ठीक है हमसे गलती हुई है, हम आपका वीज़ा नहीं कैंसिल करते हैं। मगर ऐसा नहीं किया। तो हमें यूनाइटेड किंगडम जैसे एक इनलाइटेंड सिविल सोसाइटी गवर्न्ड बाय रूल ऑफ लॉ इन ए सेक्युलर डेमोक्रेसी, उससे हमें ये उम्मीद नहीं थी, बड़ी मायूसी हुई है। और मुझे यकीन है कि जुडिशरी वहाँ के शायद इस मामले पर करेक्टिव स्टेप्स ले लेगी।
I think we'll allow the last question because the brothers.
Bhatt sahab ko hindi mein bolne.
Acha Bhatt sahab ke liye aakhri sawal hai.
Hindi mein. Hindi mein.
Sawal ke liye puch rahe ho ki sound bite? Hindi comments. Sawal ke liye puch rahe ho ki sound bite ke liye puch rahe ho?
Sound bite ke liye sir. Sound bite ke liye. Sound bite ke liye sir. Sound bite.
Ab ye hoyi na imandari ki baat to. Haan bataiye sawal kya hai?
Sir ye is pure mamle mein aap kya soch rahe hain aur aapka stand kya rahega? Kya film industry bhi isme judegi?
अब देखें ना, हमने ऐसे थोड़ी कह दिया कि दीज आर डेंजरस टाइम, वी आर द मोस्ट एंटरटेन्ड एंड द लीस्ट इन्फॉर्म्ड सोसाइटी, कि मनोरंजन के क्षेत्र में पूरी दुनिया जो है ऐसी तेजी से आगे भाग रही है कि क्या कहने, मगर इंफॉर्मेशन के लेवल पे बिल्कुल कंगाली जो है दिन पे दिन बढ़ती जा रही है। बहरहाल मेरा यहाँ पर आके खड़े रह के अपना सपोर्ट का इजहार करना सिर्फ इतना ही है कि जरूरत करने वाले आदमी का साथ देना चाहिए और शुक्र है कि हमारे बीच में एक ऐसा शख्स है जो जुर्रत करके इस किस्म की एरोगेंस से आंख मिलाता और कहता है भैया कि हम इसी तरह सहम के ज़िंदगी नहीं जिएंगे, आपको हमारी बेइज्जती करने का हक नहीं है, आप हमसे सवाल पूछते हैं हम आप जवाब देते हैं, आपने किस तरह आपने एक वन साइडेड डिसीजन ले लिया, तो इसके लिए मैं इनके साथ खड़ा हूँ यहाँ पर और मेरा पूरा सपोर्ट है इनके लिए। नहीं, इसमें तो कोई दो राय है नहीं कि इस्लामोफोबिया जो है वो जॉर्ज बुश के जमाने से जो तेजी से फैलना शुरू हुआ उसका अंत नहीं है। हमको लगता है कि क्योंकि एक ब्लैक आदमी आ गया व्हाइट हाउस में तो दिन बदल गए हैं दुनिया के, ऐसा हुआ नहीं है। आज भी इराक में जुल्म हो रहा है, आज भी अफगानिस्तान में खून बह रहा है, पाकिस्तान में खून बह रहा है, तो ये तो सत्य है कि एक इस्लामोफोबिया की आंधी ऐसे बोलने से रुकेगी नहीं। हमें जब भी इस किस्म की कोई ऐसी करतूत किसी के नजर के साथ नजर आए तो हमें उठकर उसके खिलाफ आवाज़ उठानी चाहिए।